Okay, let's get started. Thank you for joining our ThreatConnect and National CyberWatch webinar. I'm Anna Sheena, Product Marketing Specialist here at ThreatConnect, and will be your host for the next hour. Ben Schmoker, Software Engineer and Researcher here at ThreatConnect, will be walking us through the cybersecurity career journey today. First, a little bit about ThreatConnect. ThreatConnect is a thought leader in the threat intelligence space. We focus on helping security organizations be more efficient, better understand their true risk profile, and gain more value from the investments they have made in their security infrastructure. To do this, we have built a threat intelligence platform that provides three primary capabilities. It lets your teams collaborate internally and externally to produce faster and better results. It produces enriched intelligence by fusing together your human intelligence with machine intelligence from your infrastructure. And finally, proactively defends against threats through automation as well as human intervention. ThreatConnect gives your teams one place to work together so everyone benefits from their collective knowledge and talents, helps you develop intelligence-driven processes to identify, protect, and respond to threats in an efficient, measurable way, and allows you to apply everything you know about threats to all of your security technology investments to make them work better, smarter, and faster. Please feel free to ask questions at any time during the webinar. You can type your questions in the chat function on the GoToWebinar panel. We will answer your questions at the end of the demo during our Q&A session. Without further ado, Ben is going to take over and we can get started.
Hey everyone, thanks for dialing into the call today. My name is Ben Schmoker, and I also want to thank Gus and everyone at National CyberWatch for setting us up today. Thanks, Anna, for giving us the intro. So my talk today is about how to start out in computer security, and I know a lot of you are in college or maybe in post-grad or graduate school looking to work in the computer security field, maybe majoring in computer science or management information systems or something more related like cybersecurity or the other kind of intel analysis fields. My background has been in working in Washington, D.C. and Northern Virginia for the past 10 or so years for national labs and for small companies, private companies, essentially intel agencies, places like that. And I've been very lucky to have an international exposure as well as different areas in the United States, San Francisco Bay Area, New York, and Seattle. So I definitely want to share my experience with you guys and kind of help you with some of the questions that you have as someone, say, a rising senior or just about to complete your master's, and you know you want to go out there and do some cool work and get started. So the first kind of question is to just kind of do a gut check, like why work in computer security? Well, it's actually pretty cool, and luckily, you know, there's all those 80s movies and 90s movies that make it so computer hacking looks really cool and awesome, and it turns out that the reality is it's a little bit more boring than that, but you can still do some really interesting, fun things. And luckily, there's also a lot of demand for it because you know there's been a lot of news articles and a lot of companies are looking to staff up their security teams and fix holes like post-Snowden leaks. People are realizing, hey, there's a lot of issues we should fix. People talking about other countries breaking into you know the United States and it's suddenly become like a Wall Street Journal style issue. So if you have the ability to help someone protect their networks and keep their users safe, their employees safe, it's actually something that people are willing to pay, you know, six figures, seven figures for. The other nice thing is there's a lot of overlap with kind of traditional software engineering and, you know, startups and like business areas. So even if you don't necessarily want to do, you know, computer security forever, you can pretty easily kind of adapt over to being, you know, like a software engineer at Google or a security engineer at like Facebook or a different company that's not in Mountain View, but I can't think of right now. Or you can even start your own side business and do some work, you know, as a consultant. That's something that's extremely common, especially in this area, D.C. and Northern Virginia. That's definitely a viable career path, I think, 5 to 10 years in. Do some of the risks in working in this field, you know, just to be completely upfront, there's a lot of kind of buzzwords, a lot of kind of fear, uncertainty, and doubt. I tend to try and kind of minimize that and be positive, but it's good to go in kind of with clear eyes and understand that it's there. In terms of actionable advice for what I'd say for a current student, you know, make sure what you're working on has a positive impact on the world and that you feel comfortable, like, telling your family that you do it. I have on here, you know, you may hit moral hazards. You know, there's definitely opportunities to be paid to, or like, write malware or to break into systems or send spam or kind of other, like, unethical, sketchy things. And what I tend to do is I tend to think about, like, how did this have a positive impact on other people? And I actually made a GitHub repo that I could link out if anyone's interested that has kind of a Hippocratic oath for computer security professionals that I think is kind of related to this. The other somewhat less of an issue, but still an issue, is if you become over-specialized in a particular niche. So suppose you're, like, the person who is very, very good at reverse engineering and understanding, like, some extremely niche hardware that is used in, like, this type of telecom router, and, you know, you're paid, like, six figures for a few years to do that, but then technology changes, and, you know, if you haven't adapted, like, suddenly you kind of go, okay, I'm the world's greatest, like, COBOL programmer, but no COBOL programs are being written anymore. So there's some of that risk. It's usually not a big deal coming out of college, but just to kind of look for that. The warning signs for that are, like, when they ask for, like, extremely specific acronyms in the job interview, or they're sort of, like, not open to hiring, like, generalists, you know, it's a lot easier to grow someone into a specialist role than it is to build someone into a great generalist. So I tend to encourage people to be, like, have a wide breadth of interest and kind of find what you love to do and then adapt to changes in the things that you want to do over time and that has, you know, and that you get paid well to do and that demand is there. So that's why I thought, you know, just to recap, computer security is great. Encourage people to go into the field. You know, here's the just basic objective things about it. So what classes should you take, right? I mean, there's always the prereqs, like whatever, data structures and theory of comms, stuff like that. Sorry, I might have pushed the wrong button. Sorry, technical thing. So I tend to encourage people to take classes that are outside their comfort zone or outside of the typical computer science or cybersecurity specialization that they're in. Personally, I got a lot out of psychology classes and business classes, so I learned just a lot about how to design something for human beings, how to, you know, sell something to people, how to make a pitch. Because at the end of the day, you know, everyone has to do those things daily as part of their job. Teamwork is huge in the kind of real world, in quotes, like, field. You'll have to kind of defend your decisions and understand how it affects other people. It's good to practice writing, presenting, making sure to kind of get out there and market yourself whenever possible. Definitely highly suggest just, like, register a domain name, redirect it to, like, a Medium or a Tumblr site. Just post things that you think are interesting. That stuff shows value to people that are looking to hire you because it shows that you're connected with the field, that you're contributing. It also shows your voice, so you can kind of cultivate what kind of voice do you have. Is it, you know, cynical and kind of negative, or is it, like, positive and looks to try and improve things? And that's really what people want to hire, is the positive one. I also highly encourage people to look for local meetups. You know, there's always cool. There's a lot of overlap with startups and computer security. It's relatively rare this will be a group that's explicitly for computer security, unless you're in Northern Virginia or DC or in the Bay Area, there's BASEC. But a lot of times it's overlapped with a software engineering or kind of startup networking style group. But those are great. because at the end of the day, security has to interact with business and code, right? So it's really good to kind of learn about, like, what are people concerned about? I've definitely met people who, they run startups, and they're like, yeah, I'm really concerned that, you know, China's going to come in and steal our source code. I'm really concerned that we're going to have spammers on our site. Like, how do we filter that? And that's some good opportunities to both network for internships and also maybe do a little freelancing, kind of build, you know, build those connections that you can really rely on. And especially, you know, if you're in a tech hub type city, right, New York, Boston, Seattle, D.C. Bay Area, you know, et cetera, those things are pretty easy to find. I tend to really like Meetup, and I'll give you some links later that have more security-focused ones as well. So I, talking about internships, I also had a couple lessons learned from my own internships. The first one is just to not pre-filter yourself, like just to apply for everything that you think is cool. It's not as hard to get an internship as you might think if you're sitting there kind of looking at this really complicated like application form that requires you to, you know, fax them a PDF. Sometimes it's worth doing that. I will say that I got an internship that I totally didn't think I was going to get because I spent, you know, half an hour just figuring out this terrible Oracle web app to send them, like, you know, a Word document version of my resume and, you know, got it, and it was awesome. That was out in California working for a research lab. So those are the types of things that, you know, you just got to kind of, when you learn about something, apply, and, you know, you'll practice that process and kind of refine it as well. So what I tend to look at is, you know, what kind of impact can I have, right? Am I going to be working for a Google Summer of Code and really writing something that people are going to be using, like, daily, millions of people? Am I going to help the HoneyNet project with their projects? They have a Summer of Code as well. Am I going to help Citizen Lab with some of their research? There's a lot of things that are, like, beneficial and also have a commercial application. The other ones I was going to mention was, you know, Facebook internships and EFF and places like that, where they have open source, like GitHub repositories, that making a few commits to those or even just engaging in discussion on Stack Overflow or, you know, their issue comments can be really helpful to kind of start building your portfolio and finding that voice where you can then point to that and say, you know, it becomes an automatic kind of job-generating machine after a while because people just come to you and they're like, hey, you had a really good write-up here and I would like to pick you up to be part of my team. One of the things that I look for internships is, do they work around a school schedule? I had a few that didn't, and it was kind of really problematic. The good ones were either I could come in, you know, a few days a week and work like 12-hour days, or I could work remotely for part of the time to kind of make up, you know, 20 hours-ish a week. And the ones where they had a clear kind of role model, like a person that I wanted to be, like it's hard to tell that going in, but you can kind of tell by your interviewer, because typically for internships, the interviewer is going to be your boss. That kind of gets delegated down to, you know, the individual contributor level a lot of the time. So basically ask yourself, like, would I work for this person that I'm interviewing with? And if the answer is no, like, take a different job. And a lot of the time you can learn, like, especially in these formative early internships, you kind of learn what it's like to work in the field and what it's like to be kind of a professional. And I think it's especially important to have someone that you can learn positive habits from, because you'll probably keep similar habits for a while and, you know, even pass them on to others in your peer group and others that you mentor as well. And definitely engage with, you know, the global economy. If you get a chance to travel to, you know, Asia, Europe, various cities in the United States, I definitely suggest it. It's never been easier with a strong dollar and, you know, even on a stipend to hop over to some of the global innovation hubs and kind of get a sense of what are they working on, really interested in? You can make some good connections, kind of understand what it's like for them as well. I think maybe we kind of get over-focused on, like, the Silicon Valley, like, building, product building thing sometimes. And there's definitely a variety of different needs and use cases kind of around the world, and just way different, much different opportunities than we have here. And also look for, when you're in that interview and they're asking you things like, do you feel comfortable in that office? Do you feel comfortable with the people you've talked to, you know, with what that company does? If they're like a giant conglomerate, you know, do you feel comfortable with the particular team that you're on? Because you can have these sort of diamonds. We have a really solid team lead and a really solid kind of part of that company that then, you know, is part of the larger dysfunctional one. But it's important to kind of tease out, like, do I want to be here for the next, you know, potentially year, 2 years? And then that's also advice, you know, when finding your first job as well. Because I think it's sometimes problematic to switch jobs if you get like a lemon first job, because you kind of feel like, oh, I have to work here for a few years, it'll look like I jumped ship or got fired or something. But you know, it's important to kind of be open with yourself and also with them with what you need and what you're looking for. So anyway, so the next thing I'd suggest to look at is just in general, what kind of first job can I get? So you've had that great internship and you've had a great experience, found a mentor. You have about a year or two experience. You know, you have your bachelor's, your master's in computer science or cybersecurity or, you know, EECS or some kind of related interesting thing. No offense to anyone of the other ones. The kind of jobs that you can usually get out of that are, you know, software engineer, incident response, forensics, kind of reversing roles. And that's where I started, was actually in that kind of a role. Intelligence analysis, this is especially for the DC area. I don't know if there's really a market for this in other places, to be honest, unless you're working for a larger contractor, you know, like a Lockheed or a Mantech that's remote in another city or a Raytheon. But that's definitely a career path if you're interested in kind of the kind of investigative work as well as kind of getting into the intel analysis space, which tends to be pretty interesting, and also you can never talk about it ever. You can also do vulnerability research, so that's straight up like GeoHot, for instance, you know, breaking into PS2s or hacking cars. Things like, you know, you could make a living as a freelancer where you just do a few gigs a week and, you know, find a few bugs in web apps and submit a few bounties, and that's, you know, that's completely plausible. And that's the thing that's nice, is that, like, that is a completely reasonable career track. In the cases, as we go close to the bottom, I tend to recommend that people starting out start out with a day job and kind of work full-time for a few years to, like, get their feet under them. And then after you get more comfortable with what you're doing and get some experience and kind of tease out, like, what do you want to do, then you can kind of jump for more flexibility by being, like, a independent researcher doing freelance work. Just because you'll have, like, a buffer of money saved up, you know, you'll have health insurance, you'll have these things that are otherwise kind of harder to get as an independent contractor. So in general, I'm kind of dividing, you know, I divide these up, but you can also blend these, right? So my experience has basically been as a software developer slash, actually the top three, so some blend of the top three. You know, so I had the experience of working in a research lab, writing code that ended up, you know, getting used as part of government work, doing some more kind of longer term research and kind of more thought pieces, doing some think tank stuff, and then doing some on-site incident response. So making sure, you know, keeping bad guys off the network, doing forensics, picking up compromised computers, doing memory analysis, malware analysis, things like that, as well as a little bit of experience doing the more like intelligence documentation part of that, right, where you say, okay, I think that this malware was written by this person and they're trying to break in for this reason, and we're pretty sure that they're from this country, and you know, here's how you mitigate that. So kind of the more of the intelligence side. So you know what job you want, so how do you find it? So the first thing that I kind of suggest is like make it super easy for someone to actually hire you. And this seems like kind of obvious advice, but you'd be surprised as to how many applications and especially thinking of it from the other side of the table, how many of them are hard to read or have like, you know, Yahoo return address, have like a bunch of typos, or just not relevant for your company. And so in order to make yourself really stand out, and to be honest, like you need to stand out because there's basically automated filters that just filter through incoming resumes when you sign up online. And I have a note in here that basically says short circuit that process because it's actually pretty easy to get lost in a shuffle. So part of that is understanding like what is the company, what do they do, what are they hiring for? And you don't need to like dox them or, you know, run through a bunch of like, you know, techniques trying to social engineer them into telling you what they want, but just understanding like from applying to, you know, a gas, like if I'm applying to an oil company, I understand like where they're located, what they're doing, what they're concerned about. Like I can speak to the type of data that they wouldn't want stolen. I could talk about the kind of networks they might have and why I'm the best fit for someone to help them defend it or build code or infrastructure to help them. I tend to like writing just a short intro explaining that, why you're the best person. Framing it that way I think helps you understand like, here's why this is important that I write this, and also the person reading it, it really stands out more. And that can just be, I typically just write it as an email, and then just copy and paste it in the application, like, you know, cover letter thing, or if it's just an email, like reference. And that's just a way for people to understand a little bit more about who you are. They get to see your voice. You become more than just like a Word document, you know, lost in the shuffle with some keywords. I tend to like the ability to build a portfolio site, like for instance on GitHub Pages or, you know, Squarespace or any of these. It's extremely cheap and easy now to do that. It looks much more professional to have like an email address and website. You can always, you know, link to your portfolio pages, other projects, your blog, and make sure all that stuff is professional and, you know, has like a headshot and is written well. For the reason why I have saved as a PDF here, meaning like save the latest version of the PDF, because most application places still require you to like send them a Word document or a PDF. So just to make that a little bit easier, so you don't have to like, you know, export it every single time, or try and figure out how to like put it into their particular format. So in general, I try to tell people to short circuit online applications. It's good to send them in, and it's important, but like I said, they end up doing a lot of filtering on keywords. So unless you're like keyword stuffing your application, you're probably not going to get seen unless you have some type of useful cover letter or some type of skills they're looking for. I would definitely say, you know, add the words, if you're in computer security, you know, add the word cyber, add the word, you know, security, add the word, you know, add the different stacks you're familiar with. But a lot of the HR shops will, you know, filter on extremely niche things that, you know, you can't really know in advance. So basically just make a high quality resume and kind of tweak it and add stuff as necessary. I highly recommend people have a GitHub. I mean, it's pretty much the portfolio for open source code at this point. I'm pretty sure most companies, you'd be hard pressed to like get a job there without having a GitHub account with some code pushed to it. Having a Twitter is helpful. That's kind of the way that people communicate both in the security community as well as, you know, general startups and business and all this stuff. You don't have to have anything really on it. You can just, like, retweet stuff and post things that you think are interesting. But just make sure it's separate from your personal one so you're not accidentally, like, you know, linking the recruit to, you know, your particular opinions on, like, the garbage plate in Rochester and things like that. And just kind of ask people for a second opinion, right? Be like, hey, you know, here's the application I sent in. Like, if you were the recruiter, would you hire me? And, you know, you might get some really good feedback to say, hey, like, you know, I think you should tweak this thing or this thing looks weird. And you wouldn't, there's no way you'd know that in advance because it's something you're obsessing about every little detail. And, you know, someone else sees the whole thing and, you know, they might say, oh, well, you know, I didn't read past the cover page. So once you've actually been able to get a few callbacks, and to be frank, you should get a lot of callbacks if you're working in computer security, especially right now. I mean, there's a lot of demand, a lot of sites, a lot of referrals. But once you find a job that you like and you want, you kind of say, hey, I've got an offer. Now what do I do? So negotiating salary is important. I don't know if they really teach this in school, but I'll teach you it now. So the way you negotiate a salary, and I think you should negotiate a salary, even if all you do is pick a range from the starting point and have them give you a number and then revise your number like a few thousand. It's important because it shows them that you're a professional, that you can negotiate, that you understand the value of your time, of your skills, and your experience. The three-step process I had is basically just pick a range based on, you know, where you live, how much you know, like, just in general, how much you know it's going to be expensive to cover the expenses for where you're at. And if you're starting out or you have a few years of experience, you know, kind of maybe choose somewhere, like, on the mid-scale for that area. Just in terms of, like, specifics. If you're moving to DC, you should certainly ask for 80K plus. If you're moving to the Bay Area, you should certainly ask for 100K plus. That's not unreasonable, given that rents in DC are, you know, rents in DC and SF are about like a third of that. So that's completely reasonable. So once you've picked that range, your range might be higher based on, you know, whether or not you have business skills, you have particular, like, vulnerability and exploitation skills. That really raises it up a lot higher. If you've won some CTF competitions and you have some media press, things like that, or you've published some research or had some really hot internships. But basically, in general, like, don't give them a hard number. The first thing they're going to ask you is, like, how much are you willing to make? And, like, your answer should be, I'm flexible, let's talk about ranges. And they'll give you a range, and that's basically just to check and make sure that you're not asking for, like, some ridiculous number. So if you're okay with their range, then you can move forward and, you know, start talking real numbers and start talking about, like, okay, well, you know, you're asking me to move to New York City, and, you know, it costs me $4,000 a month to live in Brooklyn, so, you know, I'd like to have a housing allowance built in there of, you know, X dollars a year or whatever. And that's, again, like, that's completely expected. And frankly, once they've gotten you to that point in the process where they're giving you an offer, they've already spent probably $10,000 on you just to get you there. So it's completely worth their time to keep you in that process. And especially once they hire you, you know, that the whole process of hiring and paying someone's salary for a year is probably close to $250 at this point for a tech person in a major city. So, you know, they're definitely going to, basically my point is to say, like, value yourself, value your time. Definitely don't listen to exploding offers. I have this as a note in here. I'm very much against exploding offers or, like, strict timelines. I basically always say walk away unless they're, like, offering you just an insane amount of money. And if they're offering, you know, someone's fresh out of college insane amounts of money, like, they might have other issues going on. Like, maybe they can't retain anyone, or maybe they're, you know, doing something sketchy. So just kind of keep your eyes open there. Also remember that if they give you a signing bonus and relocation, that stuff is taxable. So make sure to account for that at the end of the year. I know some people have gotten burned by that, by just being like, oh, I can move to, you know, the Bay Area, and they're paying me a ton of money and whatever, and then at the end of the year, they're like, oh, I suddenly have a $5,000 tax bill I didn't think of. So make sure that you get a little bit of review, get a little bit of kind of sanity checks on that process. And this is just from my direct experience, and, you know, definitely defer to, as you guys learn about things from your mentors and from your experience as well. So I guess I jumped forward a little bit, but so before you get an offer, obviously you have to get an interview. So what should you talk about in the interview? You know, how do you prep? What kind of classes are useful? At least in my view, for the roles that I mentioned earlier, specifically software engineering, intrusion response, vulnerability research, things like that, also kind of product design and building things that people are willing to pay to use, like antivirus or endpoint security or network detections, you're going to want to know a lot of operating system and network kind of low-level fundamentals. You should know the TCP down cold. You should know how HTTP works, SSL, be able to use things like Wireshark, PacketMiner, probably understand host-based things, have a passing understanding of malware analysis and, you know, Windows versus Linux versus OS X in terms of how things get installed, how they get configured, or how to remove things that you don't want on a system. And part of that process is just understanding in general how to how to develop and deploy applications. So I typically tend to encourage people to become essentially a full stack developer. So, oops, sorry. I misclicked here. So understanding how do you build the back end, how do databases work, how do I build the front end, interacting with that back end code. How do I use JavaScript? What are some of the issues that can come up with the web application security? And not that you need to be like an expert in any of those things, but knowing enough about them to talk about them in an interview, because it's going to be helpful, especially when you start that job and someone says, hey, like, we have this incoming issue. Someone has pushed like some malicious code to our backend via a SQL injection, and looks like they use cross-site scripting to load the malicious script to do that. Like, a lot of things will kind of fly by, and you'll have to kind of either have enough of a background to catch it quickly, or to catch on, or to kind of Google and figure out how to do it. And the sort of dirty secret is that everyone Googles everything to figure out how it works, like, all the time, just to be clear. So, nobody is, there's no way that anyone could have like an encyclopedic knowledge of, especially computer security, which changes daily and has a ton of esoteric kind of terms of art and kind of weird one-off cases, and is generally somewhat opaque to outsiders. But in terms of programming languages, you know, like I have on here, I tend to like Python as a back-end language, obviously Java as well, C++. And C is extremely important to know if you're doing vulnerability analysis or exploit mitigation. I don't have that on here just because, I don't know, it wasn't my particular path for what I'm doing right now. You don't necessarily need to become, you know, the next Node.js, like, startup guy, but it's definitely helpful to understand JavaScript, and especially in the context of web application security, like cross-site scripting and cross-site reference forgery and other acronyms that for some reason I forget right now. So in terms of non-technical skills, you know, I actually have more bullets for these, right? So When I'm hiring someone, I really value their ability to talk through problems and their ability to work with people as a team. So, it sounds like trite, but really group projects are super helpful for this. And even to the extent where, you know, that one person that doesn't do any of the work but gets, you know, a third of the credit, like, guess what? In the real world in business, that still happens. And you do the same thing you do in university, which is, you know, as part of the report, you just write, this person didn't do anything, and, you know, here is the proof that they did. So being able to understand how to deal with things like that, how to work positively towards a goal, kind of being able to stay on track, and, like, if you have a bunch of different design requirements, you know, like keeping it on scope so that you're not adding a bunch of things that maybe you don't necessarily need. Like, for instance, you know, suppose you're building the next Dropbox, like, and someone says, hey, you know, we need to be able to natively parse, like, the old style Word documents, like .doc. You know, like, that might not necessarily be a critical feature for what you're rolling out as your application. Like, it's a nice thing to have, but, you know, it would probably take you longer to build than it's going to be worth as a small startup or as someone kind of writing some hobbyist code. So just understanding, like, how to demonstrate that with your side projects and kind of learning and practicing. One of the biggest things I'd recommend is to go to a local startup meetup and just kind of think about, like, how would I pitch my idea to this group? And not to say you necessarily have to pitch it, because that's, you know, that takes a lot of effort, and it's also kind of scary just in terms of public speaking. But, you know, just thinking about what would I pitch to them, how would I pitch it, and then kind of workshopping it with friends, kind of talking through it, will really get you an understanding of how to think about designing things. And how to, like, disagree and how to have conflicts without making it personal, and making it about, like, building the right thing and kind of coming to an agreement on, you know, maybe this person wants to add this feature, and this person wants to add this feature, and those conflict. Maybe we can work it out so that, you know, this feature gets added to the roadmap and this other feature gets kind of added later on, or maybe we explore that as a different, completely different business idea. And that's the kind of thing that, like, especially when you're young and in college, you can sort of take for granted, because that experience is much, much more difficult to have, I think, later in life when you're, you know, juggling full-time job and taxes and car registration and, like, all this stuff that suddenly takes up all your time. You don't necessarily have time to just go have fun, like, think about your cool ideas and get experience pitching them. So anyway, so that's kind of my general advice for that. Oops. Oh, so let me just check the time. So looks like we have about 20 minutes left, so I'll spend about 5 minutes kind of talking about some of the next actions I'd have for everyone, and otherwise go to Q&A after that. So, I'm sorry, the formatting got kind of off on the slide. So what I'd suggest for everyone on this call, you know, if you're interested, kind of like Anna talked through the benefits of ThreatConnect earlier in this meeting, we have an explicit URL just for you. If you go to threatconnect.com/cyberwatch, you can register for an account, and you'll have our free account, plus I believe they have a community or organization, anything like that. You'll have your own organization where you can collaborate and share on things, essentially like a GitHub organization or a shared Tumblr blog, I guess. But so that's very easy. Just need your email for that. There's a sign-up form there. I would also highly suggest checking out the Reddit hiring thread that's on our NetSec. This is updated every quarter, And it's extremely valuable, especially for people who are new in the field, because it covers internships, starting jobs, it covers all of the industries, all of the cities, all of the fields. There'll be huge companies on there, small companies on there, government places. There'll be, you know, freelancers and startups. Basically, just like, it's a really good resource, and I highly recommend checking it out. Also recommend joining a Capture the Flag team. I think there was a question in the Q&A about CCDC and places like that. So it sounds like CyberWatch is associated with some CTF teams already. I'd also highly recommend joining your university's CTF team and security group. If you're at Team U, you're probably already on that group and you don't know yet. A lot of the colleges that are marked with the SFS program, or the NSA Research Center for Excellence, I think it's called, have security groups and also have kind of their own communities built around it. I know a lot of the UC schools have really excellent CTF teams, and of course, you know, NYU and the TrailBits link that I posted here. It's kind of a good overview of what is CTF, how do I join, what does it entail, and my last point on that is I'd highly recommend joining the Seesaw competition if you're on a university team. It's the Collegiate Cyber Defense, or wait, sorry, that's CCDC. It's the Cybersecurity Awareness Week CTF, and it's one of the biggest ones. If you get in the top 10 for the quals, they fly you to New York, and you get to hang out, and probably you'll get 20 job offers there. So it's really helpful. And there's also the DEF CON CTF, of course. I also suggest people to, you know, like I mentioned, go to meetups, and there's a pretty cool community-driven effort now to do a conference in a lot of the major cities, at least in the U.S. and Europe. It's called Security B-Sides, and basically it was built as a way to have people go to a conference that wasn't as, like, sales-heavy as an RSA, or as expensive as a Black Hat, or even as expensive as a DEF CON, right, which still requires you to fly to Vegas, like, in the middle of the year and, you know, stay in a hotel. So B-Sides has a bunch of meetups in your local, they probably have one in your local city. The DC one is really big and, you know, tends to be probably about as big as DEF CON, or sorry, not as big as DEF CON, but as big as ShmooCon. I know there's one in Boston, I know there's one in LA, I know there's one in Louisiana. And if you're in the Bay Area, there's BaySec, which is a big one, and certainly get involved in that. And they're listed at the link I posted. So, and I can send out links to the ones that I mentioned as well. So, just the last thing is, if anyone would like to follow up or has any ideas or questions, you know, shoot me an email. That's my kind of, I actually started a nonprofit, so that's my email account for that nonprofit. So, otherwise, I'll go ahead and I think defer to Gus on a Q&A, or mm-hmm. Anna, for how that's worked.
Yep. Gus, you had a few questions, is that correct?
I did.
All right.
So one of the questions is, what are the best ways to practice or cultivate cyber skills? I know you touched a little bit about on competitions. Are there any online courses that we could take to do so?
So kind of learning computer security related skills. I kind of covered that, I think, in the slides, but besides what I talked about, definitely take, you know, an operating systems class or fundamentals class. You'll probably want to take a C class if they offer it, and otherwise Python. I personally got a lot out of the web application development class at my college, but at the time it was using Perl, and I think one that was using either Ruby or Python would have been a lot more relevant, you know, to modern dev. So definitely check those out. And Yeah, I tend to be biased towards technical classes, I guess, but at the end of the day, you'll be doing technical work, so I think that's important.
Okay, second question. What IT certifications would you recommend for entry-level information security positions and why?
In terms of certifications, so I think I've been blessed in that I haven't really had to get any, but clearly I know about a lot of them. I think, so Security Plus, I think is kind of the prereq for a lot of entry-level jobs, and that one, so that one I believe is one of the better ones to get as a, like an undergrad. CISSP, I think, is more for, like, graduate, just in my view, it's kind of more for, like, graduate or kind of mid-tier jobs. And that one is very comprehensive and kind of focused on a combination of policy and also technical and also kind of just general knowledge. So I would certainly say if you have the opportunity to take either Security Plus or CISSP for free while you're in school, take it. I believe a lot of schools will subsidize or have study classes for that, and those are absolutely worth taking, is what I would say. You can easily get a bump of like 20 grand by getting SSP, so I tend to recommend that, you know, but it comes down to what you want to do, I guess, while you're in college.
Okay. How can you network to hear about open jobs in the area where you want to live?
So for networking, I mean, I kind of touched on that, but, you know, besides meetup groups and just people you meet through, you know, your friends and your internships, I got a lot of mileage out of even just visiting co-working spaces, coffee shops. Look for people with cool stickers on their laptop and just kind of initiate a conversation, you know, in a non-creepy way. And just be like, hey, you know, what do you work on? Is it development? And you can kind of talk to them about what they're doing and what you're doing. But otherwise, yeah, definitely meetups, university groups, if there's a security group or a, you know, software engineering group. And definitely make a LinkedIn account. I didn't really mention it, but having a professional LinkedIn is pretty important. It's essentially like the Facebook where if you don't have one, people will look at you funny when you apply for jobs. So, yeah.
Okay. Do you need a security clearance to get into the field? And what is the process? Do you have any tips for this?
You definitely do not need a security clearance to get in the field. I will say that especially if you want to live in D.C. or Northern Virginia or Maryland, like if you want to work for the Fort or other thriller agencies, it is necessary. Or if you want to work for, you know, the military or for kind of the contracting complex, and that's a humongous industry in D.C. They often require a secret or higher I think, so the secret requires about, it's like 1 to 3 months, I think, point for them to do it. And the top secret is like 3 to 18 months. It's extremely variable. And just depends on how long your kind of like biography is and whether you've traveled to a bunch of like random suspicious places. And you know whether you're married to a foreign national, that'll make it take a lot longer because they need to vet that you know you're not like under the influence of them, you know, or the foreign state kind of thing. I mean, in general, yeah, the process for getting a security clearance is actually like not that painful. Like it's mostly paperwork painful, and just it takes a long time. But if the job requires a secret, I would say apply, and it's an awesome job that you would love and want to do. I would say apply, and that process should only take a few months, and they should pay you while you're waiting. If it's top secret, you might want to like apply and then get a different job, and then you know go back to the first job if it's one that you really really want to do. Just because it takes such a long time, and you kind of want to have a safety, you know, if they end up misfiling your paperwork or, you know, they just kind of take forever. Yeah, it's certainly just a recap. Certainly not required. If you're working in New York or San Francisco or Seattle or anywhere besides DC, it's like pretty much not required at all.
Okay. How do I determine if the organizational culture is the best fit for me when applying for a position?
So I kind of talked about like in the during the interview, I tend to look at, you know, does this person I'm talking to seem happy with what they're doing? Are they kind of overly stressed out? Are they, you know, talking about like political conflicts they're having with other areas? Like, those are all really bad signs. Does the environment, you know, typically they'll take you into like their HQ or their local office. You know, do they have like free snacks, or is everything kind of locked down with like a bunch of vending machines? These are just kind of warning signs for me, but they might not necessarily be for you. But I tend to look for places that are transparent and open and kind of willing to talk to you about what they do and why they're doing it. And, you know, they seem excited and happy to be there. I think one of the warning signs that I only realized recently was, you know, are they willing to pass your resume to another department? Some places aren't because of weird internal politics, and that's probably a bad sign, and you might not want to work there. A really good sign is when they say, hey, like, you know, we looked at your resume, we think you're a great candidate, you know, our team might not be the best fit, look at this other team, like, we've already, you know, talked to that hiring manager, and, you know, we'll make sure that, you know, they'll reach out to you and, you know, talk to you about that role. And that's I think, an extremely positive interaction, because it shows that they're working collaboratively, and they're willing to kind of maybe pass up, like, you know, local power silos for the whole company being better. So anyway, that's kind of my long-winded response to that one. Hopefully it's helpful.
Last question, how valuable is it to be part of an information technology-related organization or association?
So it sounds like that's specifically like ACM and IEEE. I think it's great. I think that, you know, being part of those, especially if you want to be a software engineer, it's helpful in terms of kind of getting experience, getting some portfolio out there and networking. There's another one called Usenix, which I suggest, which has a very, very positive, very active security group. So that's USENIX, like Use Linux, sort of. So they're actually pretty, they started a long time ago, but they're actually doing a lot of really cool stuff. They have a conference out in San Francisco called Enigma. They publish, you know, highly relevant and high quality research and publications. So I'd check that out for sure. And yeah, I think those are the ones that I kind of think of off the top of my head. I'm sure there are more that I'm missing, and you know, no offense to those ones. But it tends to be that membership in your alumni network and kind of your local startup group or your local security meetup group will end up taking you a long ways, especially if you have the ability to kind of interact and meet people in other cities and other groups via Twitter or via, you know, GitHub or these other kind of groups when you visit them.
So those are all my questions. I don't know if you want to take questions from the audience.
Sure, I think there was a few.
That's cool.
Yeah, looks like there are a few. Oh, sure, any meetups you suggest in D.C.? So if you're in this area, I would suggest checking out I can't remember the name of it for some reason. I'd recommend checking out ISSA Nova. It's a meetup group that meets at various like contractor HQs. It talks about interesting things. I'd recommend visiting Nova Hackers, which is out in Chantilly area. They tend to be sort of similar to DEF CON groups where, you know, it's participation-based and much more informal and highly technical. There's Nova Labs out in that similar area in Chantilly that works on kind of like a hackerspace slash like group meetup thing. It's pretty cool. Richard, the guy that runs it, is a cool guy. I think we're running out of time, but
yeah, thanks everyone for joining. Thanks, Gus. If you guys have any more questions, feel free to email Ben directly at ben@foxlight.co. You can check out our website for more information, threatconnect.com/cyberwatch. I really encourage you, if you have any questions that weren't able to be answered, to email Ben. So, thank you, Ben. Thank you, Gus. Thank you, everyone, for attending. Have a great day, everyone. Goodbye.
Thanks.